Let's go, Will. It's up to you.
Oh, there's a douchebag I called.
So we're kind of live now, and that is...
Hi, everybody. What's going on? My name's Will. I will not be your Dungeon Master today, but I will be your host as we return to Dawnbreaker.
Let's go, episode... Will. It's up to you.
There's a douchebag I called.
Am I right, Skag?
How's that?
sounds like seven. Yeah, feels yeah. good, man. So we're gonna be returning, and we're gonna be free falling today. Yeah, well, Kevin will be at least. So we're gonna dive into who we are, who we're playing, etc., etc. And let's start with Kevin today. So hey there, Kevin.
Hey, I'm Kevin. I'm playing Fable Brandywine, the resident psychic, or psychic. Sorry, I'm eating bacon. I keep getting reference of like something that's happened to me, but last week my internet just decided not to work
I remember.
For like the whole day. So I missed it. What's going on? I suppose I'll find it.
Yeah, you'll find out.
Good to be here.
Cool. We also have, of course, back with us the insatiable Skagath as our Dungeon Master today. How you doing, Skag?
I'm really good. I am a little bit sick under the weather, so I might mute myself and cough a couple of times, but I'm good. I'm good.
Yeah. excellent news. We also have back with us Rafian. How's it going, Raf?
I'm good. I'm excited to be here. I'm tired. I haven't had my coffee.
Me too. It's morning. Stretches. Morning yoga. Yoga D&D, the wombo combo. So Raf, who are you going to be playing today?
I am playing Elijah Castle. He is a PTSD-stricken war hero who wields a shield as his weapon of choice.
Excellent stuff, excellent. We also have with us Ishman. How's it going, Ishman? Nope. There he is.
Good, how are you?
I am well, thank you. I'm very well. Who are you going to be playing today, Ishman?
I am playing Theodore Patrick King, the much more badass than myself gunslinger. Gonna see how many people I can kill today. Hopefully not myself, but I'm excited.
Excellent stuff. And for myself, yeah, you're right, being GM, it's going to be grumpier than usual. For myself, I'm going to be playing Boris. And Boris is an engineer. He is a nice guy. But he does find himself in the middle of a war at the moment. And so, you know, nice guys aren't really what's called for. So he's had to harden up a bit. He's a gentleman, a bit of a scholar, but he does have a crossbow. He fires also. He does have bombs, which he uses now as well. And he's kind of the main guy that flies the airship. I guess him and Elijah, the main two that do that. Yeah, DC Maniac, this will be on YouTube later on. Probably within 24 hours of this being streamed, it'll be up on the YouTube. So if you haven't subscribed there, you can go and find it. But I will I'll hand over to Skagath for our next section.
Okay. I could say that for anybody who just kind of turned the monitors on, the internet focused and everything, the game of choice tonight is steampunk D&D. So it's a little bit of homebrewed systems going on, different classes and such. So therefore you will hear gunslingers and other kind of cool mechanics going on. The idea for it is that the players are the children of the past, very largely famous heroes of that time. So now when the war is rolling in, they are trying to push the advancement back and find a way to become maybe the heroes, but for definitely become the saviors of the time. How's that?
Those who were there who did the things.
Yeah. So the last episode was in fact a little bit of a brain mind blown. The episode before that, leading up to the last episode, that is to where they kind of went out a... small temple with an orb that would kind of empower the airship that they are driving. However, they saw in distance how their airship kind of flew off with Rem, an NPC to the characters. And the episode that aired last time, they started up with Fable being dragged down on the deck from the suspicious, strange chair and being pounded on, slapped and everything. And all of a sudden, things started to repeat itself. The pirate, the Barbosa, came in, and but there was a couple of changes. First time they
went back in time as well, so we literally replayed.
What?
Yeah, I know.
What happened?
Well, we did a kind of like time warp, so like we took Lucene again, but this time Sartad died.
So Sani died.
We did it great the first time. We were like, hey, let's try this
again. That was too good.
Just a little bit worse.
We had to fuck it up some more. Yeah. Zany died. We got rid of Barbosa, but it was awful. Yeah.
You didn't just chuck him off the boat?
We did eventually.
Yeah, I think it was Elijah did it.
Yeah, I think Elijah did, yeah. Chucked him out.
Yeah. Man, missed 1 week. 1 week, you guys start time traveling.
Fred, sorry, you missed the Doctor Who episode, man.
Damn it.
So that is about it as a startup. Do not recall what happened in the middle, but I remember that the ending was that you were actually traveling. I think that we played so much of the past game, so that the ending was the new one, which was that you came.
We flew on our ship and we got to a village. The village had been destroyed. We went down into the village and there was like 20 of these soldiers here who were clearly the perpetrators of the attack. And Elijah was just like, let's attack them. And so we did. And we ended up, most of them fled, I believe. And then we killed some of the others. But then at the end, the viewer decision was that there are two parachutes, but only one of them works, and Fable and Rem are the only two in the airship currently. So I believe the airship like crashed, or another airship crashed into it, right?
It can. There were an enemy ship that kind of flew into it. However, your ship never crashed per se, but it rocked so much that people went overboard, and that being Fable and Rem, the only two left there. So what we're going to start up in a sec or two is a roll to see who has the parachute that actually works. The question of the hour, I know I missed it, I've been sick and some stuff, is that so close to your enemies, where you kind of are at the moment, how do you see the battle turning out? Will you conquer your enemy, or will the battle be where people will be lost? Who is strong, who is weak? Kind of look back a little bit on what has happened and how do you see the end result pan out? Boris, you can start up, I guess.
All right, so I shall do. So let me give you that gold, sir. But it's still fucking around. Yeah, the Boris probably doesn't believe that we can win the war. I mean, like in his heart, he just doesn't really kind of feel it. You never know, you know. Like he's kind of holding out for like it could happen, but he doesn't really believe it's going to. So he probably feels as though it's not going to work out for him. That's his answer.
Fable, what is your answer?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand the question, actually.
I can post it for you. So here it is. Raven, did you get it?
Yeah, you got it.
That was muted. Yeah, so my character being the, you know, like I said, PTSD. Warrior, he is going to go into battle, do his best, Does he see a positive outcome for it? No, he knows that pretty much everybody's going to die. But he's going to go down swinging and try and protect as many as he can. We might win the battle, or we might win the war, but how many of us are going to be lost? Probably most of us. Are we going to recover from it afterwards? Who knows? I don't think I'm going to be around to see it.
Yeah, yeah. Theo, how do you, Theo, kind of see upon the dilemma?
Theo probably isn't really thinking about the big picture at this point because of everything that's been going on with him and just internally and emotionally. He probably sees like the immediate battle as he's gonna win. Like, you know, we're gonna win, but it's, he feels like he's gonna, that he himself is very weak, but that he's just gonna do everything he can. He's so angry, he's just, he's gonna go on a rampage to the best of his weak ability.
Yeah, yeah. And Fable, now that you have gotten some insight.
I was still kind of lost as to what's going on this week, but I'm sure I'll figure it out. But I think Fable's lived his entire life like getting what he wanted. So I don't think he truly believes that he's not going to get what he wants this time around either. Like, you know, it's probably going to be difficult and he's faced realities at this point, but he's still just thinking, you know, it's going to work out. It's going to work out.
I like it.
So is there anything you need to plug?
Obviously my buddy, but before we do that and we go into the live Jasmine stream, I remind you folks some ways you can interact with the show as we're going on today. First of which, if you haven't followed, hit that follow button and join us. When we hit 20 followers, you guys are going to decide what happens next in our story. You decided last show, a bunch of decisions, but first of all, that there's going to be only a few parachutes left, much to potentially Fable's doom, who knows. Following if you haven't already. Also, here's the tweet for you guys. We hit 20 retweets on that tweet. We're going to have another viewer decision. And also, we hit 2 new subscribers or Patreon patrons. If you're looking to burn your money, why not do it on Canon Roleplay? You can, of course, donate to Fetter Game. You can play in that ones, that 20s, Wild Magic Surges, Mounts, Potions, worse things as well. Check out down below if you're interested in that. And start playing with us along with us. Also at 4 p.m. today, we're back with Tinker's Tale, where Lee will be DMing again, and myself, Sydney, Kira, and Charlie, and Josh will be playing. So you've got a lot to look forward to later on today. Well, that's all me, Skag. Diving back into the session itself, my bro.
As we have done the past couple of sessions, and remind you that this is the last before the last episode. So we only have one episode more to air. So mark that down in your calendars that next Tuesday is, in fact, the ending of everything. Big finale. However, each of our kind of episodes, we have had a little intro text, and I kind of keep that going as well. War. How did they do it? How did the heroes of the past just forget the memories? Each night, each sleeping night, the nightmares came back, screaming at me, warning me. I am afraid of the dark. When the night comes, the evil spirits inside me awakes, and they only want to haunt me. Showing me the dead, showing me the destruction of our nation. Just piles upon piles of rubble. How am I supposed to live again? Come back to something with love and happiness. How am I supposed to find a life for me again? All I see is the absence of my friends, my family. I am all alone in my own darkness. It will be my blanket now. It will surround me with the dark voices that keep on pushing me towards the brink of end. Why are you calling my name when I don't want to hear you? Why are you showing me the death of my friends when I don't want to see it? And as we are starting up, the scene is the same. We are in a city that is burned to the ground, basically. We see a big ship kind of colliding with the Dawnbreaker. Dawnbreaker being powered up by the special orb. Makes it really strong so that the enemy ship more or less just crumbles into it, making small, small pieces of wood and destruction all around it. The Dawnbreaker is standing still, almost. The deck...
Dawnbreaker, fuck yeah.
Yeah. So the deck is kind of shaking a little bit, making Rem and Fable fall off the ship. The ship standing still. So what we're going to do is let Fable roll a D100 on a even score. His parachute won't go out. With an uneven score, he has a functioning.
All right, you guys ready?
Ouch, let's do this.
Oh.
So you have a functioning parachute, which kind of makes the first kill of the game, which makes the parachute of Rem not really functioning at all, leaving him to a blood pool of demise, I would
That's
say.
That's not entirely accurate. Well, now, I do have a couple spells up my sleeve, and did Rem steal our ship? I'm not quite sure where I stand with Rem right now.
So, in one timeline, Rem did steal the ship. In this timeline, he hasn't done it. Yet, or at all.
Did we figure out why he did it?
Nope. Not at all. I mean, because when we went back, we didn't know that it happened, if that made sense.
Yeah. I just...
Like, hey, Rem, if you were going to steal our airship at one point or another, why would you do it?
Why would that be?
I'm talking like I've got him. Why would you steal our airship while we just plummet to the earth? Because so, I have every chance to save this guy.
Why are you asking me? No.
Yeah. Why would you ever do that?
I think I'm going to have to save him. Just as a knee-jerk reaction to falling off. If I see, like, my parachute goes and his doesn't.
Yeah.
I think I'd save him with Featherfall.
All right. Do you need to roll anything for it? You don't?
No, I think it's just yeah, I'll get the sound or the card up there.
Feathers fall, you live.
Choose a falling creature within range. A falling creature's rate of descent slows to 60 feet per round until the spell ends. If the creature lands before the spell ends, it takes no falling damage and can land on its feet, and the spell ends for that creature.
Yeah, so it's basically a working spell as intended, I guess.
Yeah. I think so, there's a concentration check, but if I'm in my parachute, I mean, I don't see why.
It doesn't really state it.
I don't think this is like the first session, so I doubt I put all the information I needed in that spell.
You know, I think it's just more like homebrew house rules. Some DMs will make you, if you're the one falling, do like a concentration check, but it doesn't actually.
I'm sorry if anyone wanted to see Rem die, because I'm gonna save him.
We have plenty of opportunities to kill him ourselves.
Yeah, sure. I mean,
so what happens is that both Fable and Rem is falling down. And as Rem is falling a little bit faster, or maybe he got rocked first, Fable sees that he kind of rips off the rope that will kind of expand up the parachute to function. What he gets is just a small rope, and he kind of grabs for another string to pull. And nothing happens. So Fable... puts a featherfall on Rem, so he kind of slowly descend instead. Your parachute works, Fable, without a doubt. It's your own parachute that you kind of prepped yourself, so you know how to do it. So you glide down without any problem.
Probably bragging the whole time about it. Don't check your parachutes, everyone. That's what you told me. Guess who checked his parachute?
Yes, yes, Sable. We're very glad to see you alive.
I'm sorry, you didn't say it. Don't check your parachutes, okay? Yeah, sure. Southern gentleman and all that.
So Fable kind of lands besides Boris.
You were supposed to be watching the airship.
Well, I watched another ship crash into it.
Why did... In that case, you could have stopped watching and moved from watching to action.
Now, granted, that is very true, but I'm a little hazy about the last 24 hours. It's been a little confusing.
Yes, you were in a catatonic state.
I think the time travel messed with my brains.
Yeah,
so Fable, you have been more or less in bed, sleeping. The last thing kind of just took all your energy out. So you have been, sleeping. So the battle is still on. What happened was that Theo shot off like a scare shot or whatever it was called.
My warning shot that frightened them.
Yeah. So from, I bet it was 20 guys or something in a squad that was kind of approaching, the warning shot made 15 of them kind of second guessing their advancement and kind of pulling back. And a viewer decision made it so that people that had died in this village arised again as like zombies and undead creature and helped out the player group. So the people that were hesitant in the fight and were kind of going back, they were being butchered, eaten by these undead creatures. And left was the captain and a couple of his soldiers that were like, I'm going to stick this through. However, the problem was that they didn't have any possibility to interact because they were in a completely different language and the barrier was too great to really understand it. So that is where we are at now. We see that Boris and Fable stands kind of in the middle of the town square, an open town square. We see that Theo is doing a shadow kind of sneak thing. So he is in a dark alley, has just shot off a shot and I think shot a couple of guys too. Elia has put forth his demon cat. So that big demon cat just rushed in, which he called Dog. And Elia as well is starting up his momentum and starts to run at and doing his thing. So what we will do is click our characters. Just make a normal initiative roll. We don't have any characters out, so a normal one.
Initiative. Is plus four.
Sure.
21.
18.
Oh yeah. Good rolls.
Rath, what did you get?
Shut up.
Shut up. You're embarrassing me. So in this scene where everybody is doing their kind of action, we have Boris being the next in line. What do you want to do? You see that there are probably more than half being shooed by these undead. We have one captain, and the captain being on the map here, the one on the left. And then we have, let's say, four of the other guys standing to the right of him. We could actually make it so that we copy that token so you can easily understand it. So there are four of these guys standing like so.
I don't think I'm on the right
map. Skag, remind me if I'm wrong, but I think I had taken an arm shot onto the captain, so he dropped whatever his weapon was. Cecily done that last time.
Okay. Aren't you on the...
I'm on the map.
Yeah, exactly. If you go down a little bit, or go far up left. Yeah, okay, exactly.
Gotcha.
Because we didn't really have a battle map for that time.
Right, so. That's right. No worries. Yeah. So I'll throw a bomb at these guys.
just chuck some bombs at them.
Just, if in doubt, bomb the shit out of them. And that's going to be 10 on my bomb attack.
Bomb attack for 10? What is it? Is a blasting bomb? Or?
Yeah, it would be a firebomb.
So you are hitting two of the guards on the right side?
Yep.
So what is the damage?
That would be the plan anyway. I don't have 10 hits.
Is it 10 hits straight off?
Oh, okay.
No, I don't know. What? Oh,
yeah,
there.
No, sorry. Yes, it is. I thought you meant that was a hit. But yeah, I rolled a 10 versus our armor class.
And then it's 12 damage.
And then 12 damage.
Cool. So there are two healthy guards, a captain that is kind of spinning on the ground and being really angry and trying to find his weapon. So that is his turn. Down the line, we have Almighty Theo, who kind of comes in there and doing his shebang.
I would like to take a couple shots onto just the regular soldiers.
Mm-hmm. I can mark them up so that you see which one have been shot at least, or damaged. So these two have been damaged as of yet.
Perfect. I'm going to take my first shot onto the one in the back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure.
So this is going to be with Josephine. I'm going to use half my movement to lay prone, first of all.
Yeah.
And then I'll take a shot. So it is a a 9 to hit.
Yeah. Being all sentinel and stuff from a viewer decision, it kind of steers you in the right path. So you get an advantage, meaning you have a 19.
Sweet. So yeah, hits with a 19.
Mm-hmm.
For 7 damage.
7 damage.
And additional cheap shot damage for 4 more. And Colossal Slayer damage for 5 more.
So, 9.
So, 16 damage.
Yeah, he is really hurt. He's not out completely. However, your shot kind of makes him tumble back. Maybe make it so that he goes down on his knees and trying to get up, seeing a big open wound, just pulsating out blood, and he's standing there looking like, what happened? However, it's in a gibberish language, so it's hablu hu.
Habadi hu is what
he says. Habadi hu.
I'll spend a great point to take a shot onto that guy now.
Mm-hmm.
So,
what's his name?
13 to hit.
Yeah, for sure.
For 15 plus.
This sounds like a Winnie the Pooh character.
It does. Yeah, so he goes down by that shot.
Happy the ho!
Happy to you!
I'm done.
Yippee-ki-yay! Nice.
So is that your actions?
Huh?
Is that what you do this round?
Yeah, I'll call it quits there.
Yeah.
Is that all you're going to do? Just shoot a couple people? Just
shoot some people dead?
Yeah. Going wow. Down the line, I would say it's Fable's turn to do something courageous.
Yeah.
Lands on parachute. You're coming
do
down.
Do you hear what these guys are saying?
Ebony who?
Ebony who?
I guess they're bad guys. I'm still just, I think Fable's just, Fable's really lost. He's confused. He's been like supremely tired. He's waking up. He's trying to figure out what the hell's going on. He's like, oh, we're fighting those guys. Okay. And the guy in the back that's already been damaged, the very back, I think I'm going to crush his brains.
Ooh.
Standard.
You know, always. Classic. With my posted. Mind bullets. Boom.
Ooh, holy and shit.
20. Ooh.
That sounds like, ouch.
Yeah. And yeah, so I rolled whatever that is.
Is it the one more damage dice though?
I don't know. I can't. I don't know. I couldn't level up this round, so it's 2d8 psychic damage currently, unless of course it's gone up since.
But roll it again. The damage. Okay.
Another damage.
Mm-hmm. Go for it. Do it. Go.
Enjoy it. Oh. Because I rolled a nat. So I've got something that anytime I roll max damage on one of my dice, I roll again. So.
This is like.
Oh, then one.
The exploding dice. Which one were you mind-blowing bombarding?
The one in the very back that's already been damaged once.
Okay,
I'm reaching to his brain and then just hemorrhaging it best I can.
So he's about to get up after being shot by Theo, a huge open wound on his chest. Getting up and seeing that Fable slowly descending from the skies. As he touched base with ground, pulling off his parachute, he kind of looks into his eyes and get into his mind and really blanking him out totally. And he kind of just falls head first, and it is the end of that man.
I snuffed him. That'll be my turn.
You took him out. So,
wood hemorrhage again.
Eliah, you can specify which target dog should attack.
All right. And it's out of the five that I see on the screen here?
Yeah, two of them are already down.
Right, okay. Then I'm guessing the one that I'm pinging here, that's the captain?
Yeah.
Okay, then I'll have Dog go for his associate, that one.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Cool. Let's see here. Roll. And he hits.
Dog is the MVP of this game, just so you know.
Dog the demon cat.
Dog gets everyone.
Dog cat.
Don't give a shit.
Holy so shit. He hits with his first attack. He hits with his second. Okay, that was a miss on my part. He hit on the second. The demon cat pounces on him, making. Because he's a huge demon cat.
We know how big it is.
Making that the soldier basically. Gets prone by a mere tap of the paw, and that paw kind of rips open, and you can see the rib cage, some inner organs, and stuff like that. And when the soldier just hits the ground, you see how Dog, the demon cat, just pressed down his paw. Right over his face, and you hear this popping, blasting, crunching sound, and you see just blood kind of spewing all over the place. And the Dog looks back at you, Eliah, being like, I did good, and kind of nods.
They're great!
So now it is Eliah, you are up, my friend.
All right, I'm gonna be marching straight up to the captain.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm about to go ham. Well, we'll see. Well, first off, I'm spewing flames from my shield.
Hey, anus.
No, not that one. The other one. not yet.
Spewing flames.
So I'll throw it up there on screen so you can see.
Ouch.
They have to make a dex save throw.
Let's see. Roll 1d20 plus say something at least. I guess no. All
right. Then they take 7 damage. And they're on fire. Whoever I hit. I'm aiming at the captain primarily.
Oh, good ball damage, though, so.
Yeah, a little bit. I'm not done, okay?
I'm not done yet, man.
So he is on flames and starting being really panic and running around trying to find a other person. How far does it go? 20 foot.
20 foot by 5 foot. So
yeah, so it kind of hits the other guy, too. Nope. He takes the same damage, right?
Damage. And on fire. And then I'll attack with my longsword, but I only got a 9.
Yeah, that's no hit, my friend. No bueno.
And I also have my bonus actions of my mech arms. I'll attack with those, which is a 15.
I thought we had advantage on this round.
Yeah, only you had it on your account.
So the
longsword.
Even if I have
it,
it's only
on
11.
His longsword isn't sentient.
Yeah,
it's true.
Non-sentient. However, your mech arm is a little bit better.
Yeah. So I'm just reading. My mech arm says 2 unarmed strikes as a bonus action. So does that mean it does damage twice? Or do I attack twice? Or
you attack twice.
Attack twice. Okay, so there's 1. There's 2.
The first one works.
Okay. Damage on that is 4.
And I guess you do it on the captain. My captain.
Yeah,
so 11. Cool. The other guys are... as you started out the flame strike on the captain, you almost missed the other guys, but the captain tried to grab them as kind of shield and stuff. So he put fire on them as well, so it kind of spread. So now they are engulfed in flames too and trying to smother it out. They are half succeeding, half not. So they are in a poor state as it is. Rolling down, Boris, you have your opportunity.
I'm going to bomb them some more. If bombing doesn't work, bomb them again, bomb them once more.
Because bombing always works.
Bombing always solves the situation. I like to double my bombing with democracy, and I'm going to take the group of them for 17.
Oh, yes, you hit them fairly, really good.
For 13 damage. I try and get as many within the blast radius as possible.
Yeah, also seeing that there's more for a team.
it's going to be a weird thing for these guys. They're just like, gobbledygoo! And then all of a sudden, people just start blowing them up with shit.
I mean, they did attack first. They said something, something like, no peace. Attacked us.
Yeah, that was his only words he could say or something like that. No, that's peace.
Vocabulary for him to have, isn't it? I can't speak Brazilian, but I can say no peace in Brazilian.
That is only the thing he needs.
There is only war. It's the only phrase that I can say in Spanish.
But you work at a coffee shop.
It comes in handy, you know.
Weirdly enough.
So seeing that the only one who is brushing off the flames is the captain, who is now going down to one of his knees and saying more gibberish words. Hula hula this time.
hula hula.
Holding up his hands. Looking over
no
at
peace.
You. No peace.
No peace.
So, what do you guys do? I believe it is Theo who is up.
I will start walking towards him, and I will just take another threatening shot. And I will let whoever else wants to come up, like interrogate him or whatever, but I'm just there for an intimidation factor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you see that he is really, really scared to and doesn't really want to be here at all. He has no intention of picking up any weapons as is of now. And
by the way, I'm switching back from Josephine to Ethel.
Oh, yeah.
Suck it, Dad. I'll never use your gun.
Yeah, your gun sucks, Dad. I'm going to use my gun.
So what do you guys want to do as this is like ending the combat scene? You have one of the captains.
Oh god, I killed him.
I'll just delve into this dude's brain.
That's not something you should say casually. No. I guess I'll dive into his brain.
I think I'll just go in. Just root around and see what I can find.
I'll just go in, Roy. Oh man.
I don't think Wrath realizes that he's muted.
I hope not.
Nah, I hope don't do.
I did realize I was muted. Were you guys talking?
Yeah. He said I did just speak to himself.
No, sorry, my girlfriend woke up and came.
What the hell are you doing? Stop embarrassing me, girlfriend!
Mom, I'm playing a game with my friends!
We're not allowed, playing Dungeons and Dragons!
We're not our girlfriends, we're playing D&T.
Alright, I'm sorry, I didn't realize it was my turn.
We were like interrogating the dude at this point.
Right, okay, well then I'm gonna do my usual. I wanna pin this guy down and let my friends have their way with him.
And Fader Cronus for the host. Thank you, my friend. Appreciate that.
What's up, Cronus?
Yes, we wanna have our way with them.
So you see that...
I got him pinned down with the shield and you guys talked about. That's all I meant.
Nothing more.
Yeah, that's what I meant as well. Yeah, does anyone... Fable, can you speak this man's language? He seemed to say no peace and...
I can't speak his language, but I can certainly understand him. I'll cast Comprehend Languages.
Mm-hmm. So that means that you can actually... understand the words coming out of his mouth.
Mm. Translate for us.
Yeah.
Can you find out what his name is or what he's doing here, his orders?
Maybe? Sure.
Could you actually ask him anything?
I don't know. I could try to get points across. I mean, I can show him stuff in his brain. You know, I can just like project imagery. It's like, what is your name? Well, it's two nombre.
If you could be in his brain, you might be able to understand his language.
Yeah.
So,
at least, like,
can you speak it?
Could I roll an intelligence or an arcana, I guess, to root around in there and see if I can get, like, the rudimentaries of his language?
Or, like, yeah, you can roll for arcana. That would be good.
You get one phrase. No peace.
I hate you.
Eternal
world. I got an
18. That's pretty good. So you could, with that in mind, paraphrase a little bit. You could see what he is using for like grammar and stuff like that. And what you do is that you interrogate him. You get that this is what they are calling a shock troop kind of unit. They just sense in and trying to kill off as many people as possible, civilian or not. The village or the place is already sieged and under fire or whatever. They are just here to just kill off people. So what they are doing now is trying to find anybody that is alive and kill them off, basically.
Make them not alive.
Exactly.
I'll reiterate this to my companions. Well, it looks like we've got here a group of murderers.
At least he's fairly straight up with you about it.
Oh, yeah. Very, very straight up now that everyone that he was murdering has murdered him back. So this is just a very small force in the great scheme of things. But they're here to...
What are the undead townsfolk doing now?
Yeah. Who's the necromancer?
Yeah, they're slowly dying off. Their energy is slowly getting away.
That is most disturbing. Well, if he's a murderer, does he know where they might be murdering other people now? He might be able to save others if we know where they're going to be attacking.
Yeah, I'll try to ask him where the next like attack location is.
Where the other base is.
Or yeah. Where their king is, or whoever's leading this shit.
Yeah, so he kind of imitates a thought of big harbor. They're kind of marching down to the big harbor. I'm gonna reveal the area down a little bit. So, okay, we're gonna go down a little bit. So, in the south there is the big harbor leading off to the big ocean, basically.
Oceans are generally that way. So that's the next point of attack?
Mm-hmm. What do you get off the brain conversation?
What did he say? Down by the ocean?
Yeah, he's our next point of... Well, our next point of rescue is down south. There's a town with a rather large porch, and apparently that's their next step. If they're not already enacting it currently.
Well, how long would it take us to get there, would you say, in Dawnbreaker?
I
guess that's to the DM.
You have never traveled with it. However, looking past, you are kind of calculating a couple of days travel, and that is with the Dawnbreaker. However, now you have the empowering orb, so probably take it down to maybe 24 hours within.
Should we take this Captain Guy prisoner, or are we just going to kill him now, or...
I say we just murder him and walk away.
Murdering? Then we become just as bad as he is, no?
We just killed four of his compatriots while he was trying to kill us.
But not in cold blood.
Yeah. Yes, fine,
I'm not saying not to do it, but I just...
I want to be, like, standing over him with my foot just on his chest, just holding him down, my shield just, like, right over his neck, so I can just push my shield down and, like, chop off his head, waiting for their cue.
Now, why would we keep this man alive? He is here to murder women and children.
And he already has, all right.
And just shoots him in the head at this point.
So you actually do that?
I'm actually doing that.
Well, there's that.
Oh, okay. Well, it's a little archaic way to go about it, but that's fine.
I thank the yummy tubby for following. Welcome to the adventure, my friend, your gentleman and a scholar. Yeah, Boris is like, well, that's what Theo does.
Certainly does do what Theo wants.
That's everything Theo's good at these days.
Are you actually saying it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Theo cries a little bit.
Because it's so true. It's single tear. Well, everyone I love dies.
Everybody. So everybody
dies after he shoots.
After I shoot.
Everybody could roll a perception check if you will.
The man is dead.
This is what we get for dicking around.
You killed my NPC. Get fucked.
Get wrecked.
Get wrecked, noob. My perception.
I'm too busy with tears in my eyes and Fable's too busy.
What did you roll, Ishman?
green bits.
Ishman.
Yeah, what did you vote, Ishman? Let's hear what you vote.
True.
I rolled what's to be expected of me.
Rolled the higher.
Hey, and I salute Tunaf. He's subscribed for 2 months now. Thank you, my friend. I salute you, sir. Let's raise that drink in chat. Tunaf, thank you, Danny. Appreciate that, my friend.
Gentle. I rolled a natural 3. It's not that bad.
A natural 3.
So I send it to you privately. What do you see? Are you going to act upon it, or are we going to continue, Elijah? And right, a drink in the chat.
I think during this time, while we're like, Fable's done with this, so he's going to go find Rim.
Mm-hmm.
He's still on the airship. No, sorry, he's gone.
Yeah, so the thing is that Rem is standing a little bit where he landed, looking up at the airship, kind of hovering above you, looking at it. How the heck am I supposed to get up there?
Is Fable within arm's reach of me?
I'm probably leaving to go find Rem right now.
What was that, Skig?
No, he is, and he's about to leave.
Okay, as he turns to leave, I want to, like, I've still got my foot on this guy holding him down, shield over him. I want to reach out and grab Fable and just kind of lift him up and hold him back, and kind of turn him to face the rest of the group and see if they notice what I notice.
Fable, you sense that Elijah is trying to grab onto you. Probably something is happening. Are you refusing? Are you refusing it, or?
No, I don't think Fable has any reason to. He probably just thinks, I guess if he's going to lift me up, it's probably jarring. But he wouldn't resist, really, if he's like, oh, okay, here we go.
So, no. Boris and Theo, you see that a single tear of blood is leaking off Fable's nose.
I want to kind of hold them up and be like, your brain melting, Fable.
What?
It's your brain melting.
Oh. Well, that's no good now, is it?
Get a handkerchief.
Yeah, sorry. He'll, like, you know, reach around his pockets and finally find a little dusty handkerchief and, like, wipe off the blood there. It's like, well, that's interesting now, isn't it?
I'll set him back down on the ground.
Hey, Scott, can I roll, like, a history check to see if I know anything about psionics enough to know why he's bleeding out his face?
I too would like to know. I probably have a good idea, but
like I know a lot about stuff in general because I have proficiency in history. So
yeah, you can roll for it.
Stuff in general.
I know stuff. I know, like, mechanical stuff. I've worked in a shop before.
I've done a thing in the past. It was good.
I work on guns. I figure I probably know a couple things about psionics.
I like killing people. That's what I'm good at. So I've probably never.
He is probably dying, and I do know a lot about death. So
it's probably that.
Probably yeah. Dying.
I killed
a nosebleed. I'm not like, fuck, he's gonna die.
So I think every time I get a nosebleed, this is it.
This is how I go. Damn it! Damn it! Oh god, damn it!
My captain goes down of his ship.
Right, so can we roll to figure out?
Yeah, I'm sure.
I'm assuming it's because I keep sitting in that damn chair.
So what am I rolling?
Fear's rolling for history, and Fable should be rolling for Arcana, I would say.
17.
26.
Nice.
Yeah, so Theo, you remember that you have killed in the past a psionic person, but yeah, that person bled too. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so Fable, you kind of goes right back to the share, and you believe that the share is draining you in some way. And when you are thinking about it, this isn't at all your first time sitting in the share.
This isn't your first rodeo.
Nope, not the first rodeo at all.
So I've only sat in the chair once, but when I start to think about it, I've sat in the chair like a dozen times or something like that?
Yeah, multiple times.
It, you mean like I've been sneaking back down there to sit in the chair again when I'm not paying attention, or what?
Yeah, more so that you have this memory coming back of you sitting in the chair, getting small visions, and the moving back and forth in time is nothing new to you.
Hmm. Well, that's interesting. I don't think Fable's going to tell everyone about that. He's probably just going to be like, huh. Okay. I'm sure it's fine. I'm sure it's nothing. It's just a little too much stress, you know. You know, flex the old muscles in the brain, and eventually they're going to give a little bit. You know what I mean?
Not quite, but say I do.
All right, you do. I'm going to go find Ram.
Good luck.
I'm going to be keeping an eye on our good friend Fable here from now on.
Yeah, Mostly he's as suspicious as fuck.
Yeah.
For real.
Hey,
Unbreaker, guys in Fable.
After last session, the amount of mind blown with just all the different. So, with this, I'm like, alright, something's going on here.
So, Fable, you...
Our character, I agree. Boris, however, isn't on the wiser. He's just like, Fable, he does weird things.
He does do weird things, this is true.
Fable, you realize and remember the thing that you had as a vision the first time you sat in the chair?
Yes.
And you kind of realize it as you are leaving the group, moving towards Rem.
I remember the vision?
Yeah, you remember that you had a vision, and you still kind of lucidly remembers it.
Hmm.
If you want to tell the others, you can do it, or...
Yeah, I might stop, like, halfway through. It's just, like... I remember... Hooves. A war party or something. Like... Just thousands and thousands of people. Riding. It's like, we died? It's like, it's really spotty. I'm trying to, like... It's like, trying to remember that dream in the morning. I'm like... And then, I don't know, there's... Everything turns red, and there's blood and banners and mountains in the background. Huh.
At this point, I want to slam my shield down and cut off this dude's head.
That guy's been dead for like 20 minutes.
Are you talking about Fable?
No, not Fable. The guy that I had my foot over, he died.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you got shot in the head.
Who shot him?
Theo
shot
him.
Yeah,
who shot him? Old me. With my gun.
Why am I still standing? Then, I chop off his head anyway and walk away.
It's a delayed reaction. You let you off.
Yes, I missed it. Yeah, my bad. We work together, I guess. so I'll slam my shield down, cutting off the guy's head.
really delayed action there.
Super delayed action. I guess I'll start heading back to the ship.
Oh, man. I figured the munching kittens for following. Welcome to the adventure, my friends. You're gentlemen and scholars.
Thank you. Kittens. All them kittens. So you see in this scene that Fable goes over to Rem, who is kind of looking up upon the Dawnbreaker that stood like a rock against the ship that crashed into it. A little bit teared, but nothing major. You see that he is kind of wondering, how the heck am I supposed to get up there?
I read this dude's mind. Dude, I know that he stole the ship in the last timeline, right? Or do I not?
Yeah, you know that he stole the ship last time.
Yeah,
but we don't, right?
No, you don't.
Yeah. Oh, so I'm the only one that's just time travel, and everyone else, like, no one else understands that we time traveled.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
Well, that's pretty fucky.
I'm still making mind-blown things here.
So I want to, like, I want to put my arm around him and be like, well, we made it this far, Rim. And then, like, while I'm doing that, I'm going to basically just try to, like, just get into his brain and figure out what's going on in there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he looks a little bit suspicious, but in this circumstance, he kind of shrugs it off and looks up at the ship again.
I think just to help my cause, like, oh, good thing I've got some special abilities of my own. That parachute problem that you had would have been your final problem. Just like making light of a horrible, horrible situation while I'm also boring into his brain to try and figure out what the hell is his deal.
Mm-hmm. So you kind of peer through, and the sheer amount of knowledge in there are vast. I mean, he's an old wood elf, so the layers upon layers are nothing alike you've been through before. However, you want to kind of peel the outer layers, because that is what happened last. And you see that as you have traveled kind of back and started over kind of thing, he doesn't have that part of him inside. So he doesn't really have the part where he stole your ship. But you want to see more, even though. You want to see if there is something towards you as a group. The thing that you can collect is that there is a small, small tidbit, a small embryo of, like, questioning your competence and questioning if you are the ones who's going to make it.
How can anyone question our competence?
Yeah. Unbelievable. I'm appalled that they would question our competence.
So maybe in the right circumstance, that will be the one thing that could trigger it all. Mm. Sure. So
with this information, I'll probably just look at him and, like, arms still around him, looking at the airship. It's just like, with you by our side, we've got the airship and we've got a very competent group of individuals behind us. There's no way we could fail in this.
What could go wrong?
That's basically what he's saying. It's like, absolutely no way possible.
And he looks a little bit down on you, and you see that he makes a competence. Sure. I agree.
Well, we've done everything so far, haven't we?
Yeah. And as they say, the victors get to rewrite history or write history. I don't remember which anymore. It's been a little hazy there. Let's get back up to the ship.
The ship, I agree, yes.
So how have you planned on doing that exactly?
I can get up there. I can fly.
And then can you, like, drop?
Yeah, and then I can just drop the rope. But I've got fly, so I'll just cast fly and scoot on up the ship.
And he actually has the fly possibilities. He is not meaning that he will smoke something strange and believe he's flying.
I just literally use my brain to lift myself up off the ground.
Walking on this high, just standing there going.
They're flying away. Guys. Think of your happiest memory. I'm just throwing, like, dust that I found on the ground on you. Just think.
dust everywhere.
I'm on a broomstick.
So yeah, I'll float on up to the ship and then I guess pilot her down to where it's like
safest.
I can drop a rope.
Yeah. So you kind of descend. It's your first time using the ship. So with that in mind, You do actually pretty good. So you find a fairly good spot on the town center where you can almost make it land. So the rope maybe just need to get a little bit. So you put down the rope and everybody can climb up to the Dawnbreaker again.
Thank you. And I start climbing my way back up. And probably assume flight position. Flight position, go!
Yeah, no, I'll climb up as well. And I'll man the periscope.
Yeah. Thank you to Perry Periscope for following. Welcome to my friend, to a gentleman and a scholar.
Spike. That transition?
I'll climb up and I'll go to the crow's nest.
The periscope position. Hey, Momo, what's up? How you doing?
I was like, who uses a periscope like this?
Wait, do we got one that goes at the top and one that goes down, like underneath the ship to look around there?
No, I'll just go up and I'll man my shield.
Yeah, so your idea is to go south, I guess?
Sure. Yeah.
It's our next destination.
I told everyone. You were paying attention. Okay. You were just looking at this guy like, I'm going to kill him. As he was dead.
Yeah, he's already dead. I'm just like, I really want to kill this guy.
You didn't pay any attention to what did go on around you. You were more like, I'm going to kill you so bad now.
Everything was just shut off. Like, ears, eyes, everything. You're just staring blankly like...
Death. Murder.
Murder the murderer.
So... A little bit from each of you, a small thing that you do, as it is quite a long journey hour-wise, is there something that you want to do specific on the ship? Exploring stuff, checking out certain compartments, or meditating, reading, or whatever. And we want to thank another one.
Unique Wonderland for following. Welcome to the adventure, my friend. You're a gentleman and a scholar. Yeah. We're going to do some reading, I think, and just some soul searching.
I think, yeah, Fable's going to look for like something to eat and then just a place to rest his brains.
Brains.
And recharge his spells.
Wait, then who's flying? Did I miss someone?
I thought you were.
Oh, I mean, I could read well.
Yeah, huh? Why not?
So we are letting...
I'm like, whoa, how did I get here?
Tweet. Let's see the tweets.
An actual cow. That's how we find Dawnbreaker.
Have anybody said that you cow?
A little bit to the left.
Have anybody fed the cow? Anybody feed the cow?
The back udders go right and left, and the forward udders go up and down. So it's just, you know.
It's a mess. So what did Fable do?
Fable went to go and root around for something to eat and then probably take a nap on one of the hammocks in the mess hall.
Mm-hmm. And Elia, you were...
I think I'm flying,
piloting.
Right?
Yeah, you should be probably piloting. Theo, what do you do in the trip-wise?
If I have time, I want to make some ammo and search compartments of the ship.
Mm-hmm. So you make a couple of ammo for your guns. That's up to you to distribute. And the ship kind of sails smoothly through the air. There is nothing that is taking up time and space. You all feel a little bit taken by what you have seen. A lot of your known places are being burnt. The landscape are shifting colors from bright autumn fine color of red, yellow, green, and whatever, to more blood, black, and ash. You sense that whatever you do will reflect upon the whole nation, as well as the nation you're probably gonna go to. So the weight of whatever is about to happen makes you either feel sad, reminiscing on the good times. However, it kind of just wears you down a little bit. So everybody is a little bit drawn back, not talkative so much, and trying to let time pass, basically.
Not to think about it too much, probably, for Boris.
Yeah. Do Fable do anything on the ship regarding the share room?
Am I, like, kind of compelled to go back to it?
Not if you don't want to.
I think Fable's still trying to get, like, he's like, something's going on with this chair, and he's still trying to figure it out. He knows, but he doesn't know.
Hmm.
I think he's just kind of like sleep and meditate.
Hmm.
Yep. I think that was the plan. Unless, of course, you really need me to go back.
No. So this is the share room, so people can see where it's at. The trip itself takes about 24 hours, a little bit more. So you left during the midday, gunning through the evening and night. And after a while, the morning starts to peek through again. You have a couple of set rations, so food-wise, you're good. The trip itself is taken without anyone really speaking, trying to recollect what is happening and stuff like that. After a while, you see far, far away a big mountain kind of being divided, almost like a passage through, where Rem is saying that that should probably be a good spot to land. And if we're going over the top, we will be very open and visible if there is anybody kind of down by the harbor area.
We get a good, like, periscope on the area.
You do think that you have, like, a periscope.
We must have a huge one. It's just a cow. And we point the cow and ask what it sees.
There is no cow and there is no periscope.
So we don't even have like a little spyglass or anything.
You can go up the whatever it's called.
Crow's nest?
Yeah.
Alright, we'll call up to Theo there. It's like, what do your elf eyes see?
He's talking to nobody because I'm not up there.
I thought you went up there. You said I was gonna go to the crow's nest.
I was, and then afterwards I was down looking around. It
took like 5 minutes. You just climbed up there and then climbed right back down.
Yeah. All right, fine. I'll shimmy up the crow's nest and see what's up.
Okay, good idea.
Oh, I see nothing.
I'm blind.
So,
there's nobody up there.
Do you need me to roll perception, because I'm bad at it?
Probably to see how much or how far you see things.
Well, I got a 5, but if you give me advantage.
No. So what you see up across the hilltop leading down is that the humidity has taken over, so there is like a white, almost thick layer of mist showering down, making it really impossible to see. However, you see movements coming down in the same direction you are coming, as they have come the exact same way as you have. They have gone over the mountainside and now are going down to the harbor. So you see their backs, basically, as they are marching away from you towards the harbor where you are looking. Mm.
So we're like, we're behind the army now. That yeah. We're trying to, do you think we can we get in front of them? Like, can we boost Dawnbreaker's speed, get around and like warn the town or anything?
You could probably. However, you're not so certain that the town is fully operational. If the war and everything has taken its toll, probably that have been hit as well.
Hmm. All right, well, I'll call down to my compatriots. It's just like, hey, if you look at the right side of the ship, you'll notice a giant army. It was a bad joke, but there they are.
Oh, look at the right side of the ship.
Can we take these guys? I mean, surely the town has its defenses, no?
Oh, well, the town's got to have more than just six people on an airship. Or is it five now? Oh, it's five.
Zany.
Well, poor one out for our compatriot. I say we try to head them off and go to the town to see what we're working with here, because we could harry our foe from atop, but there's no way we're going to do enough damage to stop them.
Perhaps we could lead them off, draw their attention away, get them to chase us.
That is true. We could probably take if we become a large enough problem, we could take a large enough force away from the army that the town might stand a chance.
Agreed. Let's head into the town first.
Of course.
I want to be positioned at like near the edge of the railing, like over, like looking over the army or whatever we're flying over them, and like considering just dropping down on them or not. It's like got one foot on the railing, just looking down, like
dropping down one here.
What?
For any individuals on the ship who think it's a good idea to attack this army right now, it is not a good idea. Please stay on the ship.
Please keep all hands and arms
inside the vehicle at all times.
Yeah. Hands and arms. You can have your arm out, just not your hand.
No.
True. Just true.
Elbows.
Pretty straight going.
Yeah.
So, I think we're gonna try to head them off and get to the town before they get there.
That's a plan, yeah.
So, so you are heading over the hillside or the mountainside, and when you kind of caress the top and looking down at the harbor area, you see in fact 10 ships in your size bombarding the town as of now. And you see small pockets of the same size that you defended off in the city center are going in kind of a couple of minutes in between downwards towards the town itself. So these are the kind of shock troops guys that are going in for the kill, so to speak. The town itself is slowly pushing back.
Mm. All right, gentlemen, we've seen the power of our airship, and I think air superiority is something that we need to take control of. Let's take out these ships.
Let's do it.
Battle stations, gentlemen.
I say, milk that cow dry. File the forward udders.
See how much we have. Oh, we are.
Weapons swivel like straight down at all or no?
We're not shooting at the people, we're shooting at the ships.
Yeah, the people are down. The ships are in the air, let the bad guys.
Mm-hmm. Okay. If we take out the ships, we'll at least take out their air support, which would be a very huge boon for the town.
That was the saddest okay.
Okay. In that case, can't kill any civilians, okay. So we are
speed.
High up in the air amongst the clouds and slowly making our way against the other ships. Let's see if we can actually
do we kill Barbosa properly in the end?
He kind of fell overboard.
Yeah, right. I feel like he's still going. He's like the Disney villain.
Some say he's still falling.
Thank you, Mr. Damp Cobra, for subscribing. Thank you, my friend, for that Twitch Prime. I salute you, sir. Let's raise that drink in the chat for the Damp Cobra. Thank you, my friend.
One more.
Damp Cobra.
That's a moist cobra right there.
Very damp.
Damp Cobra at first. You're like, let's raise a drink for that Damp Cobra.
Man, like that Damp Cobra.
And make them feel welcome, don't you?
Coming up in here. Cobraing around.
Some people.
Stump people.
So yeah, ramming speed.
Yeah, I'm not opposed. Also, who's driving? Because whoever's driving kind of gets to dictate.
Yeah, I'll turn the speed to 11, and then charge directly into the mass of them.
Like, all right.
So what you see is basically the town underneath, which is the black circle there, and we can go for a little bit of a reveal up here. You see the ships are chasing down and trying to bombard it as best they can, pew-pewing. So it's a little bit depending on which side you want to go to and stuff like that. So it's up to Boris, I think, to sail it off.
Draw them away from the town, he'll call it, the crow's nest.
Yeah, I guess I'll take an angle which is not going over the town. Let me get onto this map here. So I want to kind of go over the, let's see what I'm doing here. Yeah, to the left side, I suppose, where that arrow is going, that 70 foot, towards kind of this general direction, to try and lead him away from the town.
Direction.
Yeah. So you are traveling full speed, could make you come over here?
Sure. Four, and I say fire.
So you can actually in this vicinity hit the two in line, so I'll make them green, a small little green icon on them, making them able to be shot at. As you are progressing through, you see the remainder of ships as well.
I say, and the massive fleet, fire!
See that right there? Blast him!
Broadside!
So, who is firing?
Guys!
Is Elijah firing? Is that the one who's start up?
Yeah, I mean, I can't do anything until we get there and I can board their ship. I'm the boarding party.
We should not board any of these ships. There's like 20 fucking ships.
Yeah, boarding is bad. There are four of us, one of which needs to be at all times.
I'll man the guns and start blasting everything I can.
Okay, do Elias you...
just jumps out.
I'll like load myself.
There are three of us.
Misses like the boat totally and just goes down.
Alright, no, I'm in the guns. I'll start firing all the shit.
So you roll a d20 plus 5.
Yeah, scary, isn't it?
Yeah. Roll a d20 plus 5.
Are you using a cannon or a Gatling gun?
Probably using the cannon because I like big guns.
I like big guns again, not lie.
You appreciate all
big D20 plus
5. D20 plus 5. So you hit. You do a roll 4d10s.
They are utterly destroyed.
Hey!
Got him! Plus 2 pun damage.
20
to myself.
That is 3. It was 1 more. 4d10s. 1 more. 1 more.
Oh,
yeah.
40.
40.
Come on.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, 40.
Everyone knows a dawn.
So what you do is you are aiming at the sides of it, trying to pierce through, blasting open a big part of the side of the ship. And you see it kind of makes a little bit harder for it to steer, as it's not aerodynamic enough. So it is Theo. You are manning the Gatling gun, or
trying to break some doors.
Well, I saw that the cannons were kind of mounted on like movable mounts. Can I just pull one of those over to the other side?
Yeah, for sure.
So I'll take a second cannon onto our starboard set.
On the side where the ship's
on. The sides. Oh, Jesus. Ship nerd.
What ship did Elijah attack?
He probably shot that one, yeah.
Alright, so I'm going to take a shot at the other one.
Mm-hmm.
And if I can manage, kind of aim for the cabin or whatever, like the...
You know all this terminology, Theo. It's like you're born and raised on a plane. I'd like to shoot at the hole with the people.
The bigger part. So you're trying to aim for the place where people are at. You roll a d20 plus 2.
Plus 2.
Mm-hmm. You're trying to aim, my friend. That's not the easy right. task.
You're trying to think.
Yeah. So
that's your problem.
That's your demise, my friend. So you see your cannonball just froze off and do not hit anything, basically. Just pass them by.
Too many minds.
It's like I fired my cannonball and it lands perfectly in one of their cannons ready to be fired.
Back in.
That's the Nat 1 right there. So
that'll be.
I wonder if that ever happened before in history. You know.
Well, I bet. It did happen once, yeah. And they probably were like, "Well, that's."
So, Fable, do you want to do anything specific?
Is there any way I can draw as much attention to the ship as possible? I don't know.
Sane was pretty good at stripping naked.
Yeah. But even then, these other ships in the distance, I just think I'll
get naked in honor of him.
What do I see on this ship closest to us? Can I see into the cockpit?
Yeah, for sure. They are standing and pulling levers, being all professional and stuff.
Sweet. Well, I'll just I'll take aim at the whoever's driving the damn ship and just crush his brains. So
crush braids.
Nat one, baby.
So
my mind bullet went directly into their cannon, ready to be fired back.
So you see the captain looking up on you and shouts out something, and they are now directing all their powers to your vessel.
So, like, yeah, I reached out and I, like, try to get in there, but it's just, like, there's so much stuff going on that I get a little distracted. I'm like, ah! And then I'm just like, gentlemen, I believe we've got their attention.
I believe so.
So, the next round will be kind of their own, where they are planning to turn and go this way, and they will attack with their Gatling guns, and they will have just a deal 20 plus 20. Nothing. God damn you. Nope. So both Elijah and Theo see how this smaller vessel about not really half the size of Dawnbreaker, but close, kind of stares around and comes up side by side, and you see one guy, there's just one Gatling gun, starts to really pummel through, and he misses. He shoots everything but you guys, so you feel
they
lucky.
They got stormtroopers!
It feels like it. Not nat 1, but I mean, yeah, you need like 15 to hit, so yeah, no. No, no. So starting up the round now.
The bullets just like spray around the ship, and we're like, how did they miss?
So every ship.
We start talking mad shit now. Yeah. Like, oh, you said, look at this idiot.
Man, guys, you almost had us.
Didn't even hit us.
Hey pirates, what did you roll? Get on my.
So they have moved a little bit, and it is starting up with you guys. Boris, do you want to stare around anything, move?
Yeah.
Why not?
Why not? Let's get kind of like parallel. Oh, we already are parallel. Like, let's wrap around so we can kind of, I guess, let me get my tool out. If we can kind of get here-ish. Kind of here, so we can broadside the backside of the first one and maybe the second one as well.
Yeah, so you go up here and you turn, so you kind of go this.
Sure.
An intelligence check, maybe? Something to do with the steering mechanism.
Which udder do you pull?
There are two, up, down, and sideways.
So you just pulled one of them sideways to go sideways.
Oh yes.
24. I know everything about these others.
Oh yes, you do. Yeah, pulled levers in your time. That's all we can say.
Probably say more. We don't need to.
No. So in this case, you are liable for hitting more of the ships. This ship, however, is the one that you have been shooting at. So that one has both a green icon and a red icon. And yeah, so Elijah, what do you do?
I guess fire the next cannon.
Mm-hmm. Which ship do you shoot at?
I think it's time that we at least bring one down, so that one.
Mm-hmm. A D20 plus 5. Yeah, you do hit. You do hit.
And then what was it, 4?
For D10s.
4. No, 3. 4. 4 D10s.
Whoa!
That's
like,
right? No plus anything. 19?
And yeah, one sure. And the last one again. Wow.
I mean, yeah, why not? You got to keep it like
consistency is what we ask for.
That's the word. Yeah.
So 19, rambling it up to 40, making it falling down to its demise.
Oh, yeah. Right in the middle of the city, baby. Just what? Oh.
Just what we wait. Just where all those innocent people are.
God damn it. So it is Theo, what do you want to do?
Land on their ship and steer away from the city.
Yeah, I'll fly you onto the ship, don't worry.
Okay, sure.
No. So Theo, what do you want to do?
I'll take a shot to the other ship.
Yeah. Do you want to shoot or you want to aim or what are you doing there?
No, I'll just shoot. I can't really see the cockpit from here, so I'm just taking a
D20 plus 5.
14?
Yeah, it hits. You can roll 3 times if you want to.
Well, I can get 3 attacks?
Oh, yes. This is a Gatling gun. You spew bullets.
You spew. I'd like to take the spew action, if possible. There's a bonus action spew.
Spewing.
Alright, so an 11 and 20.
Yeah, so two hits, and it is a 2d10s.
Each?
Yep, yep. So you can roll if you want to, 4 in total. Yeah, so what you do is basically on these small airships, there are a couple of guys standing there with very, very antique in your mind rifles. Probably the ones that you front load and take forever to load. Like old muskets or something. And they're standing there and waiting for being able to board your ship. And you just spray them over with some bullets. And there are just a bloody pile of people. Really, really wrecking. Yeah. So looking at this, your Dawnbreaker just pierces through. Robert, you will kind of circle around the smaller ships trying to invade your space. Both the cannons and the Gatling guns really making holes everywhere, blood everywhere, small ships just falling down. When you have taken your turn slowly around, I'm not really turning the ship either. So I've done like a full kind of turn around the battlefield. There is not a single airship left. Every airship is falling down to the end. And yeah,
what's that?
Fucked them up.
And Dawnbreaker is just slowly pacing through. And
take a single fucking hit.
No, no.
Like, we turn to one another, like, we just killed, they're all, okay.
Okay, yeah. Terrific job, gentlemen. I knew we could do it. I'm a little surprised we did it, but I knew we could.
Yes. And Boris sits down, I think. Sits down on a chair somewhere.
So at this point, you're kind of hovering over the harbor, the city that has the big harbor. You have two options now, either to go down and see if you can help out, or you can go back from where you came and take charge against the coming soldiers leading down to the city.
I know how you like do that. We have like a horn. We have like an air horn on the ship, and we just kind of...
Aruga, aruga.
It's the PA system. It's like, the town below. This is the Dawnbreaker. The SS Dawnbreaker.
We're here to assist you in your death today.
And then we start bombing them ourselves.
Yeah. We are going to bomb this town first. No, I think Fable's all in favor now that they've... their air superiority is no more. Now we just go and just charge straight through the middle of their army and just Gatling gun the shit out of them.
So
exactly, that's exactly the plan.
So you drive over. You see that the only way to actually attack them in a proper good way is either by ground or wait in the city. If you're waiting in the city, they will kind of start the siege of the city. If you attack them, you can attack from the behind.
Hello. Also, welcome to Yudi? Yudi, you're a gentleman and a scholar. Thank you for joining us, my friend.
So we can't just aim the Gatling guns down and just fly over kind of low over the top and just pop, 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 pop.
Nope. It is too narrow of the mountain sides, so it would be like trying to get the ship kind of tilted down, and then you will just fall off. So, nope, nope, yeah. Nope. Not right, hearing no, it.
That makes sense.
Not hearing
I,
it.
Like, I think Fable's in favor of, because we have Dawnbreaker, it doesn't make any sense not to use her. But he's also like, we just get in the, if we can save most of the town and get their attention on us, we could probably draw quite a few of them away from the town.
On the other hand, if we go and we warn the townsfolk where the attack's coming from, that there is a second attack in the first place, then they can prepare themselves. We can position Dawnbreaker between the town and the army, centering all our guns at them, you know, with us being like lower towards the ground.
Don't we have an arsenal, like the guns and everything on our ship?
Yeah, yeah. That's
what I'm saying.
Yeah, no, yeah, that's also a really good idea because we've got a bunch, we got an armory and they've probably got people who are fighting. We could rally some troops and have them join us on Dawnbreaker and just ream any people who are coming in at us.
Because like, yeah. As they come by, since he was saying it's a narrow path, it's a choke point for them. So as they come through, if we're lowered enough to the ground where our guns aren't like down, then we can just use our Gatling guns, you know, right at them and just mow them down as they come through.
Yeah, yeah, just set up BMG and kind of the choke point. I like it.
I'm good with that. That's a great plan.
Well, Boris just begins to fly them down then.
Yeah. I think who's going on the scouting party to rally some troops for us?
I think our chief negotiator / ambassador, Boris.
I need to be here to fly the ship, surely.
Yeah. I could go, I guess.
I'm going to be working, because what we're planning on doing is pretty much stationing the ship, having all the weapons on one side so we can just blast, right?
Yeah.
So down below, just moving all the cannons over to one side of the ship.
Fable, I think either you and me or you and Elijah should go down to the town, tell them everything that we know and you know, see who'd be interested in joining the fight. And then either myself or Elijah, whichever one of us stays, can start getting the arsenal ready. You know, make sure the guns are cleaned and prepped. And
I mean, I could just go myself if you guys didn't, because I'm sure there's an army coming at you. You probably want as many hands over there as... And I could find some people pretty quick, so probably.
Yeah. He's just going to probe all their minds and be like, join us.
Basically. Puppets! That's puppets!
One of us.
Join us. Yeah, so I'm going to bring in the ship to, not like land, I guess, but like hover just above the ground.
Before the town, so to speak, yeah.
Yeah, and a trick point. So we can set up all our guns and just kind of unleash hell.
So you want
to
wait, let's say it is in this way, so maybe kind of like this, wait for whatever is happening.
Does Dawnbreaker have napalm? That's the question.
Fair question too.
Is our little gyrocopter, that thing's toast, isn't it? We never fixed it.
Yeah, we never fixed it.
Yeah, well, shit. All right, well, Fable's going to go jump off the side of the ship, like, I'll be back, gentlemen, and run off towards the town to go and find some people.
Mm-hmm. Is there time to fix the copter before the army gets here or no?
I'm working on it. I'm moving all the guns, the big guns, the cannons and stuff over to the one side of the ship.
Are the cannons are on their own? Yeah, they are actually.
Yeah. I guess we can turn it around.
So you can move all the
parking. You could
pedal parking.
We just fit into the airship, like little docking space in a car park. Makes for all the carriages and horses. Excuse me, sorry.
It's a tight fit, but I can fit it. Right over here.
Did someone go pay and display? We need the ticket, or else they're going to fine us.
Pay double. It's quite a huge ride, you know?
If we get clammed, that was it. Basically going to park it up and start kind of manning the guns, I guess.
Yeah, so the copter is out of the question. Boris needed to work on it for like a 24 hours thing, which never had been done. So Boris. Leading Boris,
I didn't even know it existed. I didn't even know we had a copter. In or out of character.
It's been there the whole freaking time, dude.
Well, yeah, we had to move around it to fight it.
Yeah.
We had to move around a thing on a map. I mean,
we had to move around it, and it got mentioned multiple times in a couple of those fights. Like, oh yeah, someone else fucked that up even more, so it's gonna be even. Oh.
Yeah, the first time you fought Barbossa, he kind of knocked it.
You might want to fix that.
Yeah, that's on you, Otter. That's on you.
You were just so into your pigeons that we didn't want to interrupt you.
Don't want to interrupt us. I mean, the pigeons, let's be honest, are more effective anyway. So,
of course.
Well, that's arguable.
No, it isn't.
Okay, so Fable, you are going down to talk to the townsman?
Yeah, I'm running around the town trying to find the fighting townsman and rally some troops for us.
Yeah, you find a kind of guards, milice, trying to put out the fires at this point, recovering people. Mending and in general just fortifying everything back.
Yeah. I suppose I'll talk to some guards and then I'll look for like a high point, like a pile of rubble or, you know, some point where I can get up in a group of people and just call out like any able-bodied men wanting to protect the town and everything they love, follow me. We have ammunition and guns if you need it. We've got a choke point and a plan. We can at least stall this army so your loved ones can escape. But probability is we're going to take a lot of them with us. And I'll try to rally as much as I can.
You can throw down I would say...
persuasion check?
Yeah, probably. If you're not wanting to intimidate them, do as I say.
No. Absolutely. This is a call to arms. This is... the good old red, white, and blue is coming for you.
Yeah, if there...
red, white, blue speech, and I got a 23.
If there ever was a time when people are dropping everything, where the local theater group are starting to pick up their instrument and playing along as you're doing your speech, and almost like a presidential kind of elect...
Do you hear the people singing?
So you are standing on top of a wall just preaching and they are eating up every word. The officers are, oh, that sounds like a marvelous idea. Let's go for that. Whatever he says sounds like the best idea never been brought up to our attention. And you see that the officers on the ground kind of points out to people, take 5 men with you, take your troop with you. And within a couple of minutes, you see a steady group of 40 people starting to, okay, we are ready. Let's go.
All right. So I'll tell them that, like, bring your ammunition and everything that you have to fight. We also have some extra weapons. We'll be sure to load them when we get there.
Mm-hmm.
We'll have to make a couple trips back to grab some stuff to make a little bit extra barricade. But we're the giant airship over here. And then I'll, like, you know, lead my men out with the drummer next to me.
Yeah. The officers are standing, like, almost being proud of sending their own people with you. Oh, these are my men going with that amazing man. Oh, I love him. I probably will kind of set off my daughters in his name. I could, like, take my own home, that marvelous man. Did you get his name?
At the end of all this, if they survive, they're going to be looking back as like, why did I even care about that guy? It's like mind, but just completely mind screwed. I'm just like, yeah, I'm your friend.
Did you get his name? No, but I know I like him. And I love him. He's such a glorious bastard, that man. And they go back to their trying to fix the fortifications and realizing they are 40 men last or whatever. But they do.
Like, I'm just imagining that, like, you know, the home battalions were like whole villages of people would go off and they'd fight together in a war and then they'd all die inevitably. And then like the entire village has no population afterwards. That's exactly what's going to happen. Like the theater group are going to be devoid of any talent for the next 10 years. It's going to, they're going to be doing, you know, the just awful plays.
The plays are great. It's the issue is that the people doing them is just terrible.
Yeah. No talent in the town left.
How do you do it? Should they kind of climb rope for the man, or do you try to land the ship as best you can?
We landed the ship on the ground, didn't we? Or are we just hovering?
At this point, we are hovering.
Yeah, I'm hovering at like 20 feet or something. I could race down road ladders.
Yeah, let's lower some ladders and all that stuff and get some men on this ship.
Can we do a thing? Because can we like open up like the front of it, and then like they can fire out from the front maybe?
Open up the front. What do you think this is? Like a cruise ship?
No, it's just a like boat.
Back, maybe because we've got like bay doors in the back, perhaps.
Bay doors. This is the steampunk. It's not like future.
Well, do we have a Fallout vault door then that opens up?
You could if you want to, yeah.
Yeah, just something for them to fire out of, because otherwise they're going to be kind of useless, because we don't need that many people on the guns, because they're a foil.
Well, I'll take some of them, I'll explain to them, it's like we needed like, you know, 10 of you up on the ship with us firing down, and the rest of us are going to start building fortifications down here underneath the ship. How's that sound?
Yeah, that sounds good. So a couple of them are actually trying to find the fortifications along the sides and trying to help out. I could actually show you the guns that Theo is using, so we get a little bit of feel for it. The question was, what kind of guns do we use? I think I had it somewhere. The amulet to see in the burn.
Hey, what's up, Lee? How's it going? How was Poland? Poland.
So this is the guns that we are using. Steampunk guns. They are revolvers. They are repeatable guns. So, yeah. As long as it's kind of steampunk and cool, we take it in.
Cool.
So you are setting up one front against this canyon going down, and a couple of people are setting up fortifications along the sides where there are some possibility for doing so. I'm going to write up.
Sure. And thank you to Chris for following. Welcome to the event, my friend. You're a gentleman and a scholar. Thank you for joining us. Yeah, most likely Blackwing, I'd imagine. That gun, if it was invented in 1890, might be around in our world. Because we're around that kind of...
It looks like a pretty cool gun.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
So what is happening is that you are preparing for the fight, and preparing for the battle. And after a while, you see the sheer forces of people coming down in formations. And the pockets are about 50 men strong in each of the pockets leading down. There are about five of these groups. A small head count would be a couple of hundred. Being so that in between you see these big mecha robots moving forward as well. We can put them in. Let's
Mecha
see. For
robots.
Mecha robots. Activate.
I'm gonna use my mecha robot.
So I pulled it up here for you guys.
Blue eyes, white mecha bot.
They don't sound like that. Stop ruining the game.
I knew you would draw that card. No.
You activated my trap card.
Trap door.
Sorry, Skagit. That's funny, though. Those are awesome. I don't want to fight it.
So these are amongst the groups of soldiers leading down, and you are waiting for the actual assault itself. So on the ship, do you have positioned yourself about where you want to sit in the assault?
Yeah, I think I'm below leading my troops, my 40 or my 30 men that are down below the ship with our fortifications. Yeah. I'll probably stay down there just to keep them rallied and there. So
Fable is low below, so to say, yeah, on the ground.
I'm below the ship, but I'm behind some fortifications and a couple guys. So,
Boris, where are you at?
Probably on one of like the Gatlings.
You are testing out the Gatling guns.
Yeah, I guess I'm on the helicopter, 24-hour working on it. No, I
you should have.
No, I'm on a Gatling gun and kind of getting ready to just rail it off.
Spew some fire.
I'm ready to spew it, that's right. Get some spewage.
And Elijah, what is your intent?
I'll be manning the cannons until they get like too close. Then if someone else wants to man the cannons, I'll just drop down in front of the ship and use like my flamethrower shield and keep as many people off the ship as possible. So that way
we are going to keep those men as far away from the ship as possible. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah. I'll be on the cannons until they get too close. Then I'll drop down in front of the ship and keep them off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, Theo, what is your idea? Where do you want to be? You are muted, my friend.
You're wrecked, nerd.
Nerd.
Noob.
I wasn't talking to you guys.
Obviously.
I already used that excuse.
I have other friends.
So I've been getting like guns and ammo ready for the townsfolk, but I guess once the battle starts, I'll probably hop on to probably the Gatling gun first.
Mm-hmm.
But I at one point or another want to stop Elijah and hand him Ethel just in case.
Yeah. So what you see after a couple of minutes is the share kind of waiting game. You, Fable, being on the ground with the troops of the village, you sense that they are young, they are inexperienced, and they're really afraid, they're scared. Some of them are tearing up, they're trying to focus and kind of hiding behind the rocks at start, and some of them are starting to talk amongst themselves of, we're going to survive this, right? We're going to do it. And some of them are trying to share on, and some kind of just fell through and are starting to melt down.
So how are you using this time to actually teach them how to use the cannons and kind of giving, like, inspiring, you know, like patting them on the back? Like, hey, you know, you'll be all right. You just man this, and I'll watch your back. And
did you, in fact, put up any people on Dawnbreaker?
Yeah, we put 10.
10 people.
Say, they should be the ones making the guns. I mean, we've got enough cannons up here that we need people for them.
Yeah, because we've got this ballista as well that someone needs to get speared.
So yeah, trying to find a...
Yeah, because there's 30 men below. I had about 40. There's 30 men below, and then we put 10 on the ship with them.
Yeah.
Right.
So I'm going to put down a... This is a boy token.
Boy token. Only boys can have it.
You just assume it's gender.
Oh my god.
With a beard. Yes.
Just because it has a beard and it's clearly male does not mean it's a girl. This is 2016, Skagit.
God damn it.
So I'm going to teach all these people how to use the guns, and then... you know, I'll be inspiring them and working with them up until, you know, the battle commences, and then I'll be helping them fight, obviously. And then once, you know, the enemy gets close, I'll drop down with Dog and cover the ship.
I want to thank Gonna find Crimson Phoenix, donates 5 pounds and says, "You have activated the Phoenix trap card. The airship rolls 1d10k. My lord.
Oh.
Thank you, Brian.
The airship has 1d10k. Oh god.
Then it must be me who rolls the.
That would be Skagger.
100, 1,000, and a 10.
It's gotta come through, Brian.
Oh, crap.
God. Is this good or bad?
The pier gate. So, Will, what will happen? I don't have the link. I don't have the link for that shit.
Well, you're a moderator. You should know what it is, Skagus.
Well, I am like behind-the-scenes moderator.
Exclamation point, Wild Magic. The link is in the chat for you there, sire.
Oh, why, thank you.
Sent me in a helicopter all over again. Skagus, you went to work on that table for 24 hours straight.
Seven, six, five, two. Should work to do like this. 7652. There. Target's weapons induces vertigo in anyone wielding it.
Shit.
Wait, what? Can you
God damn it, Brian.
That's not nice.
So everyone manning the cannons on the ship are going to get vertigo.
That is right.
It's really easy, okay? You just load the...
So almost every personnel, that being the young people that you brought up, they're really... spewing. They're puking. They're really...
We are spewing now. That's what we're doing.
Yeah, we're really spewing. They're not used to the airship. I get it.
Hi. Just, how are you, Matt Fishman?
So, what you do is... Hello.
Hello there.
Well, hello there. Talking all good and stuff. Well, hello there. It's me, Ishman. So they are not at all prepared for the immense vertigo going on. They take out their rifles instead. Oh, we'll keep this instead. I don't believe the guns are for us. So
I'm throwing up as well then.
Yep. You can now kind of not really count on the weapons aboard the ship.
Oh, shit.
Fuck you, whoever did that to us.
Crimson Phoenix is to blame.
Everybody throw rocks. Rocks.
Throw rocks.
We've still got, like, guns on top of the ship, but it would have been very nice to, you know, have Gatling guns and ballista and cannons. We're fucked.
Can we still use them even though we're being sick? I mean, like, just
took an entire turn.
You could use them, bit like -7. I mean, you're feeling vertigo when you're using them. But I mean, you could do like a high roll and like a d20 or something. So with that plus, it would be -2 on a d20.
Okay. Let's give it a go. Roll 20 is loading. There we go.
It was so so perfect that it was like the vehicle's weapons.
All of its weapons. So I kind of like I kind of grab it, and I've just been sick, and I'm like, this is gonna hurt, but I see them coming, and I like grab it, and I'm I'm milking while speaking.
So
I rolled a 9.
Yeah, so you are shooting everywhere besides at the actual point of entry. Does that robot count as a weapon on the ship? The robot, the helicopter, is taken out. The robot in the picture is actually what is expecting to hit them soon.
Yeah, so the robot is what we're trying to fight against with these weapons that causes them vertigo.
Yeah, so there are a group one. There are five of these as well. So you have your work set out for you. Down the line, Elijah, would you want to shoot or do you want to change up your strategy?
Well, I was primarily just trying to get everybody else trained on the weapons so that they would be more effective. And then, I'll be dropping down in front of the ship with Dog, waiting for, like, I'm standing there just, like, shield at the ready, you know, just kind of waiting to see the whites of their eyes kind of thing, waiting for them to get close. And then me and Dog will go on in.
So you jump down, basically.
What's that?
So you jump down.
Yeah. I don't want to go out yet because we're just going to get shot in the back by our own guys.
Yeah, but that's your turn. You're waiting in and jumping down with Dog. And for anyone who hasn't been looking at the episodes, there is actually a demon cat somewhere in the line here. And that demon cat is actually pretty cool. I can actually agree with that in mind. It is somewhere here and it is all over the place. As you see, I have too much. Here is actually the token for it. So, yeah. Leading down to Theo, what is your intent?
Do we already see the enemy?
Yeah, they are now approaching, yeah.
Alright, I will not using the Gatling gun because I don't want to kill my own people. I'll pull out Josephine and take a few shots with her.
Hmm. Yeah.
I'm gonna load in some fire ammunition.
Fire.
That is a 16 to hit.
Yeah, you hit for sure.
That's 24 piercing plus 6 fire. And that, that's all I get for now. I don't get cheap shotter.
No, so you could basically headshot a captain if you want to.
I'll headshot whoever looks the most important.
Who is what?
Whoever looks the most important.
Yeah, so you take a captain that is leading his troops. You headshot him.
So I want to thank Blackwing as his 3 pounds says Nat 24 to use on his attempt to avoid the vertigo. Thank you, Blackwing. I'm no longer going to be spewing.
So for this time around, Boris is immune. He understood the trick. The anti-vertigo. But that's not. But that is on your turn. Fable. What is that?
Can I take another shot?
Yeah. For sure. Sure. I miss that you are shooting so much.
Yeah. Are there any? Is there anyone there who's already been damaged at all?
Not really. This is your first. No, this is just a startup.
I'll take just another shot with a thunder ammunition now. So that's a 23 to hit.
Yeah, for sure.
For another 24 piercing and then 4 lightning damage or thunder damage.
Yeah. You can't really shoot an officer as of yet, but you can probably headshot another kind of sergeant feel to it, so you're demoralizing.
He looks important.
So you have demoralized this section of the troops leading up to you. Coming down to Fable, what is your idea?
So can I see one of these giant mech dudes?
Yeah, far away. Yeah.
So if I can see I want to see the mech dude after I see him take out the officer or whatever. Mm-hmm. I'd like to aim at that mech that's part of that group.
Yeah.
And I'd like to cast a suggestion on him.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a very long explanation of what it does. But basically, I get to suggest a course of action on him. And I can't tell him to harm himself, and it's got to be plausible. So I think I'm going to word it as like, you know, it's just like, you're now in command and you never really liked these guys. Their lives don't matter to you. Blind okay. fire.
Okay.
So that would be my thing. I think he's got a, yeah, I don't think he survived the check.
No. What he does is responding very good to what you have suggested. So he'd be like, yeah, these freaking bastards is always in my way. I better just squash them. So he starts to run instead. And yeah, so he just bull rushes the whole troop. They get more demoralized and really start to run around. And you see the group from afar, they are starting to kind of, what is happening down there? And start to push a little bit further down the valley. You see also that the mechs are now trying to kind of group up. So the first mech robot in the back have waited for the other ones to come up close. Mm. So they are now pushing the troops down and letting the mechs stand from afar and shoot, probably. So they are not doing anything this turn. It is so much chaos. So you all get a kind of a bonus round. They will probably start shooting the next round. Mm. So
can I command at the end of my little, like, you know, like, I'll command the mech to go just fucking haywire. Mm. And then I'll also like tell my men, like, or my kids who are down there, it's just like, fire at that unit right there. It's just like, they're demoralized, we can beat them, you know, just kind of rally the troops and also get them to start firing their weapons on
the mech.
Yeah.
What was that? Yeah, so you're trying to make as much ramble as possible. So you see that the groups are now really, some of them are running back, trying to get back to the bigger groups. Some of them are shooting almost each other. Someone is trying to take down this mech robot and just trying to survive. It's a complete chaos in the first line.
So, Frog wants to use his monthly wild magic surge on one of the enemy mechas, if possible.
Yeah. No!
No, on the bad guy. Probably going to be good, right?
No! So, it's probably going to like grow 6 times in size or some shit.
So
no,
what,
don't worry, Black, we came through completely fine, my friend. It's just the notifications on.
Oh, so he wants to use a D10 on...
On the bad guys. The bad mechs.
Yeah, we're taking the mechs that is more a bigger deal. Oh, yeah. 6299.
9-9.
Huh? Target is thrown into the nearest briar patch.
Hey, that was good. See?
Not bad.
Oh, no, briars.
Where's the nearest briars?
Like so, 10
miles away.
In all this, the first line that is kind of pushing down towards you, complete chaos. You have this mech kind of stomping people, shooting haywire. Some people are trying to get it down. Some people are shoving each other. Some are pushing back. You see one of these mechs in the back, they're trying to make like a line having so that they can shoot you from afar. One of the mechs are trying to really do what Will talked about earlier, trying to fit in, snuggle in, back in, doing like parallel parking. And he gets really caught up in one of the feats. And you know when you have this game when something just hit a hidden object and the weapon, the vehicle, the player, whatever it is, just flies up in there and just...
Corpse launching.
Yeah. Yep. Orbit launch. So what you see is a mech that just orbit launches itself up and just passes on to the Bolivian of somewhere
it
down.
It catches one of its hydraulic coils and the thing, it tears.
Yeah. Yeah, so you hear this kind of really exploding sound from one of its coils or something. So you see this big stream of light and explosion sending it far away. So you get the sense that everybody quiets down for a bit and what the hell happened?
The whole time Fables is telling the boys down there, it's just like, we got this, look at that, this army sucks.
So bear in mind that Fable made like the best presidential speech ever. They're like, yeah, I don't know, but I love this gorgeous dude. I mean, whatever he says seems so true. And what he says, I mean, comes true too. Look at this.
He's so got a General Patton thing going on, a big flag behind him.
Yeah, you have your own drummer boy. As I once...
They keep getting a new drummer boy each time. Bring me a new drummer boy.
Drummer boy.
What an honor, sir. I can't wait to...
Next one of you.
So leading up to the next sort of segment, Boris, what do you want to do? Bear in mind that you have overcome the vertigo.
Yeah, in that case, I'm going to...
Fire a Gatling?
Fire a Gatling gun would probably be the thing that I'm about to do now. So,
A D10 plus 5.
D10 plus 5. Let's see if I can do that.
And you can roll it 3 times.
3 times, shit. A 21, a 8.
Modest 8.
And a 12. 21, 8, 12.
So you are shooting far more than just 3 bullets. It's like a section of bullets. Spewing bullets. So you are really hammering down on the ground forces. And
bullets covered in vomit.
You are more or less taking out the first line of defense, and the first group that are attacking is really almost gone. There are a couple of stragglers just coming back up, and you see this total destruction. The mech robot is full of bullet holes, and kind of after your after this exploding sound of Gatling gun, there is almost like a mist of gunfire thing over the enemies, and you see the mech robot tonk at the end, and you see like 2 people running back to the others, and almost F this, we're not gonna do it. So in the next round, that's the round. We have Elijah, you jumped down with the demonic war cat called Dog, which is here. And what is your intent? Very close is Fable. And he is with a couple of, I think it was 30... young soldiers holding their ground.
All right. At this point, I'll kind of look to the rest of them and then raise my sword and point forward and kind of charge out, kind of leading the pack. If they don't follow, fuck them, don't care. Dog's with me. yeah, I'm going to charge forward and try and reach the first wave that's coming down on us.
Mm-hmm.
So we got a giant war cat coming in there and destroying things too.
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yes, we can.
Yep.
Hopefully, we'll see.
Everybody except Fable can roll perception.
I can never roll
perception. No, never roll perception.
To perceive or not to perceive?
Well, Boris, it's on, you. Boy. Yeah, yeah, it's you. It's you. Come on. Come on. Come on. Do something. Do something. Yeah, you don't really see anything. In case the 9 was not bad enough. Fable, you feel almost like you are slowing up. Everything around you kind of makes this very slow pace. You see these guys running away. They are just slowly. And what you see is almost like someone had dimmed your whole peripheral view. And you're standing there, you're looking over your shoulder, and there is a person in a very drapery clothes, like a cloak with a hood and everything, and it is standing very close to your left side and is watching at the exact thing that you are watching and kind of admiring what you are doing or whatever. What is your first kind of reaction thing to it? Do you want to look it more over? Do you want to ask, say something? Do you just wait until something happens?
Does this seem familiar to me? Like weirdly familiar or no?
No.
So basically time is slowed.
Yeah.
And I'm just going to, I suppose I'll be like, hello, how are you?
Hello there.
And
I'll initiate conversation with this being.
Now the cams were back. I kind of shut down soon for a sec. And you see the face of a person being which you haven't seen before. And we will up it up a little bit.
Well, that's unsettling.
And it looks you over and you sense this deep fright inside of you growing like a heartbeat that just keeps on pounding. You feel this urge to make everything stop, just go away. It could be the presence, it could be something. And as it kind of turns and looks at you, you feel that it doesn't need to even go into your mind or make something. You instantly get this should we say shared mind together, and you see that he is, or the being is, somewhat the maker of almost every evil that has happened so far. And it looks you over and says that whatever you do, you will never be able to turn time to your favor. And it kind of smiles in a very crooked way. And you see that it looks over the sheer chaos in front of you.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to rend his brain.
Go for
that's
it,
my plan. If I know that, if I can feel all that and he's talking to me there, it's just like, wow, let's go. And I'm gonna cast Rend, which is not my highest level spell because I couldn't level up properly, so I might have been able to get a better spell, but this is the best we got.
Let's go, man. Let's go.
So I got a 19 plus 6 plus 6 plus
it's good
So 19 plus 6 plus 5. If he saves, he takes half damage. And if he's hit by this, he is, I believe he is vulnerable. He'll have vulnerability to psychic abilities.
Okay, so what do... Okay, so you roll an intelligence save throw?
No, he rolls. No, so he's got to save.
Yeah, but you roll it.
Oh, I roll too. Okay, then that makes sense now. 18.
Okay, so you do half your damage, because what happens is that you penetrate and do whatever you're supposed to do. However, you sense that he kind of takes that and just share it back. Your mind, your kind of inner thought is kind of prepared for it, still a little bit clustered by the being and the presence of it. So what happens is that you get half the damage, which probably is like 20? No, 15.
So it's 19, 15. So it's 15.
Yeah, 15.
I did 30 damage. So I take 15 and I guess he does.
And that what?
I guess he takes damage too, or did he hurt him at all?
Yeah, he used like a legendary talent and threw it back at you instead.
I don't like him.
Oh, damn.
Me neither.
And he kind of keeps his eyes peered through it, through yours. This challenge is far too easy, don't you think? And looks over to the hillside leading up, and it is almost like the ground is crumbling, making small cracks, and from those cracks a black mist appear. And this is something for everyone to see. Afar, probably behind the mechs, really behind everything, something is kind of crackling up, and a black mist is just spewing up is the word that we're using, spewing up. And from the dark kind of forms, some entity is formed, and Fable, you see this entity standing beside you, smiles and say, "Oh, this is gonna hurt, don't you think?" And slowly you see that the time is starting to go back, and the mind presence shared between you are slowly fading away, as it is kind of getting back to a original state. You could share something if you want to, say something like an ending sentence if you want. I hate you.
Oh, dang, I gotta come up with something really cool to say to the boss man. Guys,
you gotta have a one liner ready at any given time.
Yeah, I know. I feel like I've spent all of them on these in speeches. I don't think I have any left. They're probably just like, oh, eat shit.
Oh, well.
And I know he's gonna beat himself up for the rest of his life over that. Well, I talked to the god of evil and I just told him to eat shit, which is actually pretty awesome when you put it that way.
That's true, yeah.
So, you guys as a group do now see a huge, standing twice the size of the mech warriors, a demon of plague, spewing out these horrendous kind of acids around it, walking down.
Awful.
And slowly just walking downwards to you guys, and the morale in your groups are really clustered now in Fable's group of 30 guys. They're this is not gonna go well. So the end scene that we are panning out of is Dawnbreaker slowly standing its ground. We see Boris is really hammering down from the Gatling gun, we see that Dog, the infamous demon cat, are making its pass through. Elijah is running up towards both the soldiers, the mech robots, and now this demon of pestilence that is slowly walking downwards. Theo is getting a cool kind of stealthy part from the side of the mountain, get ready his guns and start shooting at it. And Fable is standing a little bit confused and taken by the whole scene itself, and slowly getting into mind that this is now happening. Hopefully we will get by. And yeah, that is a good ending position in the midst of demon of pestilence and mech robots and soldiers running down towards Dawn a Breaker, towards the last finale kind of episodes next week.
Next week is the last episode of Dawnbreaker, so if you want to find out what happens to us, then you're going to have to wait until next week, until we see the end of this campaign, and most likely the end of us, by the sound of things. Certainly Fable looks like he's in trouble again today. Every week ends up with Fable in Dangerous.
It's kind of cool because it makes me feel like really important, but it's also not cool because I'm just like, oh, I die? Come on, guys.
Oh, guys.
I knew I should have chosen a different character. Being the wizard is always dangerous.
It's yep, unfortunately so. Well, we're going to dive off from this game here in a second and go into our next one, which is going to be Tinker's Tale, where these back to DM for myself, Sydney, Kira, Charlie, and Josh. So stick around for that. But let's go around and do the old whip around the table here and do some hooks and plugs, shouts and stuff like that. Of course, if you guys did enjoy this show, then stick around for the next one and hit that follow button and join us, because we're going to have viewer decisions happening in the next show. And Tinker's Tale is usually filled with shenanigans and lesbians. Woo! Ooh! So let's go around the table. Let's start with Gagath.
Well, hello there. I am Skagath the Magnificent. I do D&D stuff over at my channel. It's Skagath. You can join me up there for a couple of days now. Seeing me kind of prepping for a horror game coming up here on Encounter Roleplay soon. Other than that, I do small gaming here and there. Kind of cool. That's all for me.
Awesome. Also, just at the very end there, Aaron Law donated £3 and says next PC die roll is a nat 20. So we can make a note of that, Skag, for next week so that we can have a nat 20 to launch things off, because it feels like we might need it beginning next week, seeing as it's finale. Thank
was it an Aaron. NPC or was it a PC?
Next PC dice roll. So God whoever damn. Rolls first next session is a nat 20. So we'll make a note of that. So we do not forget it. All right, Raffian, same questions for you, my friend.
Questions being the usual, who I am, where to find me, and what are my thoughts on the game?
Yeah.
Why
not? Let's sure. That. I feel like, just like how every single end of the game, Fable's dying, I'm usually running towards dying. And I like it. I am a little afraid of next week because I'm pretty sure I'm going to die next week. But we'll see what happens. I'm excited. I'm really excited to see this ending though. I think that in the future there may be a Dawnbreaker 2, maybe. Who knows? I mean, I might spam Will with messages every single day saying, so Dawnbreaker 2, eh? Hey, you never know.
I don't know if we could say Dawnbreaker 2 until we figure out what the hell's going to happen next week.
Yeah, might have to be like Ripbreaker or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
But anyways, you guys, I'm Rathium. I have my own stream. You can go over there and check it out. I do D&D and variety games on mine. So if you're ever not fulfilled with Will, just
filling you up, then you can always jump over to mine when he's not online. But yeah, we have a lot of fun over there. You can come over and make fun of me calling every kind of name. I'm pretty sure I've heard it by now. So lots of fun, lots of good stuff. Huge party, hype train stuff. Okay, bye.
Got it. Same questions for Ishman.
Yeah, so I'm Ishman. You can find me on Twitter and on here at Ishman223. I do have my own channel. Don't really do too much on it yet, but I will be soon because I'm actually partnering up with Rathian as part of the Wrath faction. So in the interim, you can find me either in here on Will's channel or over at Rathian Gaming's Twitch. As far as today goes,
go ahead. Make my day.
I am so excited. This is the fight that Theo has been needing this entire storyline so far. So he's ready to go ham and just like completely shoot everyone twice in the face. I'm having a lot of fun right now.
Good. Glad to hear it. Finally, Kev, a question for you.
Hey guys, my name is Kevin Bolivar. You can find me on pretty much any social media site as KevBotRL, including on here on Encounter on Twitch. When I'm streaming, I'm on. When I'm not, I don't have a stream. So there's that. I'm mostly on Twitter and Instagram, and you can also find me in the Dungeons & Dragons web series known as Experience Points. It's a scripted Dungeons & Dragons web series by gamers, for gamers, kind of taking you through the whole world of Dungeons & Dragons and through a basic play session, but getting rid of all the fluff. It's a fun play session that goes from point A to point B, and the theory is that you'll enjoy the characters and the story that we tell because we enjoy the characters and the stories that we told. I've got a bunch of projects like in the works, but you know, financials always tend to get in the way of making them happen. But I brew a lot of beer. And I do a lot of board gaming. So I'm hopefully going to marry those two and get them onto YouTube or something soon. But we'll see. Anyways, please follow me at KevBotRL on all things social media.
Absolutely. Go check it out, my friends. So what we're going to do is we're going to head into this next show here, which is going to be Tinker's Tale. You're going to see the stream go down for a second. It will show us offline, and you'll cry in sadness as there is no stream. And then with elation, you'll realize that actually it's only been a few seconds, and the stream is back up again for the Tinker's Tale. So don't panic too much, guys, because we'll be right back on again with our next show, Tinker's Tale. With the cast and crew back for some more shenanigans in this coming game here. So go follow these guys, hit that follow button and kind of roleplay if you haven't already, and we'll see you guys in a minute. Until then, try not to roll too many nat ones because we want to be here laughing when you do. We'll see you in a minute.
Bye.